From my 10 years in Texas, a plastic pack of small tomatoes from HEB has been my weekly delight. Every week, when I open the new pack, there is a new picture of a worker who collected tomatoes. They worked for hours in the field while I was doing about anything else, read, watched TV, swiped leaves on the balcony, walked through the spaces of HEB with security mirrors here and there, or indeed stared at the pictures, rendering their portrait and a brief personal story. The harvested meat, eggs, and milk are produced outsourcing animals, often with extreme cruelty, many argue animal abuse. Fewer people will frame plant harvesting as exploitation of plants, but it is undeniably exploitation of humans. I imagine small tomatoes, like parts of the body, red bulbs of juice, dropping from the tips of the worker's fingers. The Deleuze and Guattari's body without organs is, in this case, a body with too many organs, where there is no line between the human and the plant. The package made workers personable to consumers through pictures and stories. The stories are supposed to be endearing and also raise awareness. They do both, even if the stories are picture perfect and too pretty for consumption. In one of the apartment complexes where I lived, one apartment was taken by a couple of older people, a man and a woman. The administration of the apartment complex tasked them with maintaining the orderliness of the place, in return giving them a discount for the rent. In the evening, the man often smoked at the red pickup while looking at his phone. I couldn't help but see her reclining on the sofa in front of the TV while I was climbing the stairs. They would have to check Hispanic or Latina on many papers that the USA Everydayness makes you fill. Younger people, who I assumed were their many children, nieces and nephews, visited them often. The truck was loaded and unloaded. People arrived and departed. The couple helped a lot of people with various tasks. They were respected elders in a buzzing community. Next to our shared apartment complex, a nice Austin neighborhood spread its wings. With manicured lawns, the houses presented as if an embodiment of the American dream. There were no fences. You spotted a security sign that indicated that the property was protected. Some of the lawns were decorated with a sign, "In this house, we believe." You know it. Black Lives Matter. Women's rights are human rights. No human being is illegal. Love is love. One house was markedly different, an anthropologist's delight. It was a house of a very few neighborhoods avert Trump supporters. A scooped old gentleman and his gray-haired wife lived there. He had a slogan across the house, "We believe in socialist distancing." Dems, USA, suck. Gop, America, great. Tough decision? His car sardonically inquired through a sticker, "Guns kill people, then spoons cause obesity." Around the Texas February freeze, the neighbor adorned the house with the apocalyptic message, "We are all going to get what only some of us deserved." Evidently framing the political defeat, pandemic, and the freeze at once as unmistakable signs of the end of times. I wondered where he gets those placards, orders them individually, or there is a mass production somewhere. I was walking by his house every day, getting crankier and crankier about the poor fuck, a rotten soldier of the COVID-stricken empire. I wondered if my neighbors met at the street, and if so, was the exchange of greetings taking place between them? I continued enjoying my tomatoes weekly. A little ecosystem of a city nook continued functioning, some comfortably living like myself, others constantly on the verge of being stopped and frisked. The ringing security of the streets echoed in my ears. Somehow I perceived them as being see-through. A book by Sara Lynn Lopez, The Remittance Landscape, Spaces of Migration in Rural Mexico and Urban USA, reconstructs the landscapes arising somewhere else from money earned in the USA and passed on to the relatives or saved for retirement, houses built and restaurants opened. She calls it migrant architecture. I always imagined Austin's cozy neighborhood a migrant architecture as well, but in a different sense. It outsourced and continues doing so, everything from tomatoes to toothpaste to create a haven for some in the world increasingly unstable and troubled, where, as Derrida observes in opposition to Fukuyama, more people suffer than ever in human history. In the recent convention of the Association of Slavic, East European, and Eurasian Studies, at the panel Socialism, Past and Futures, Ksenia Cherkaev asked what kind of future we are trying to build. Is this not the time to begin imagining something different in addition to what we already know? We know, or think we know, socialism and the imploding neoliberalism that Ksenia insisted at this point are similarly or dissimilarly bankrupt. Indeed, not only does neoliberalism not bring satisfaction, but it doesn't even promise it anymore. We need something different, perhaps radically different. But what, how to build it, and how to make it work?